Can we praise God for this praise team? There's 16 people on this stage. Amen. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you, Brother Richard, for reading for us today. Well, I'm so grateful, as Richard has already proclaimed, to be in amongst God's people. Amen. Even as we are living stones built one upon the other, we are the house of God. Well, listen, hey, if you're blessed and you know it, clap your hands. It's a little thing I do to get people woke back up, you know. I'm so thankful that you've chosen to worship with us here this morning. I'm not prone to going over business meeting minutes the Sunday after the business meeting was held. We had an on-call business meeting this last Wednesday, though. Quickly, I'd like to say, and we praise God unanimously, it was decided we would put down payment on building materials for the new building. Amen? Amen. Now, that being said, I want to make some statements. One, as moderator, I was not recommending that. And I said that in the building meeting. As pastor, I feel as though one of my jobs is to encourage people to walk by faith. Amen? And as I was speaking with Ed this morning, as an under-shepherd, I think one of my jobs is also to bring people to a precipice of choice, a precipice of choice. Now, as moderator, I did not recommend that, nor as pastor did I recommend it, because it's unethical. I cannot commit your faith for you. And when I say you, I'm talking about the handful of people that were able to make it the other night. I know, beyond a shadow of a doubt, there are people that wanted to be here but cannot. And then there are others who are like, oh, it's a meeting. I'm definitely not going to be there. The famous saying around here when I was coming up in ministry is I'd rather take a beating than go to a meeting. But as pastor, as pastor and moderator, I want to tell you right now, I will never present another thing to this church in a business meeting without having the representative of that thing. So Andrew, anything else you want to do, you're going to have to be here to defend it. I really felt a little naked the other day. Not your fault, not your fault. Not pointing blame, just fixing an issue. There was a lot of questions. And I want to tell you, I was so encouraged, Desert Hills, because we had our usuals, as Zach calls them, our usuals, the people who have been here long in the tooth. Excellent questions, valid concerns. Why? These folks are invested in what God is doing here. So I was very thankful for the feedback that we got during our question and answer time. And I was super encouraged, and church, you should be encouraged, because we had several new members, not the least of which was Giovanni, who is in construction, who got up and he expressed his concerns and his thoughts on the project to come. Now, all of that is to say, in the context of wearing two hats, the moderator and the pastor. Now, as the pastor, my job is to interpret what has been said by God's people and, again, make application. And I hate to do this, but Andrew, what I interpreted was we need more information. We need more information. And again, not your fault, no blame, but we need more information. We're going to be looking for a little bit more of a step-by-step process, brother. I know we sent you that email. But I wanted you to know that this has been addressed. As your pastor, I did hear that. Does that make sense to you today? As your pastor, I did hear that you would like to be clued in a little bit more on the process. And I apologize for not having, well, all the answers to your questions the other night. All I can say in my defense is I presented you with what was recommended by the builder, this guy over here. He's the brains, you know. But that being said, he's got the brains to not only put this thing together and see it through to the end, Lord willing, but also to give us a little bit more of a roadmap to it, okay? Thank you. Can we praise God for Andrew today? Amen. And for those of you who came to the business meeting the other night, I just want to personally extend my gratitude to you. I know business meetings are boring. I remember when we first came to Desert Hills. We came from Desert Hills, as many of you, from another church. And those business meetings at our other church were terrible. But Wednesday nights was not terrible. Our business meetings here, well, they're on call if we have business. Very rarely do we have business like this. And at call. But we have one business meeting a year, and I want to encourage you, if you're a born-again, baptized, bona fide member of Desert Hills, to attend those if you can. We have them on Wednesday nights. That is difficult, but I definitely want to keep Sundays for our worship time specifically. Does that make sense? All right, so now that I have broken my own rule in going over business meeting minutes or concepts and themes on a Sunday morning. Let's pray and hear what the word says. Amen? Amen. Father in heaven, greatest God Almighty, I thank you, Lord, for this day. I praise you again for the men and women, the boys and girls you've brought here in our midst. I pray, even as Richard has prayed, that you will save souls today, that the saved will be obedient through baptism, and you'll continue to grow this church, Lord, that you will give us disciples, born again disciples, to fill the classrooms that we are believing you for. Truly, Lord, there's not a square inch in this church that is not being used. I want to say this, Lord, with all humility and gratitude for you and your people. Father, your people are such good stewards. Such good stewards. Every square inch of the facility you have given us these many, many years is being used efficiently, productively, as good stewards, Lord, for your kingdom, seeking your righteousness. I pray, Father, for those who are here today who have yet to be scripturally baptized, that they would be a good steward over the faith that they say they have in you and come forward by the end of this message and make a commitment to be baptized as soon as possible. And as you continue to grow, Desert Hills, one committed Christian at a time, may you be glorified through the good works that you do in us and through us here at Desert Hills. We love you, Father, and we praise you for this nation where for now, at least, we can still come and worship in a moniker of safety and joy, Lord. We pray for our nation. We pray for our president. We pray for the upcoming elections. And we pray that your will be done. As your will is done, Lord, I pray that you find your people faithful. We love you, Father, and we praise you. In Jesus' precious name, all of God's people said, amen and amen. Well, we are still in our summer series, even as our summer banner finder contest is continuing on. Miss Lana the other day asked me, she says, are we done with the banner contest since school has started? I'm like, that's the end of summer for kids in school. The end of summer actually is in September. So we have enough banners for me to go out and hang until midway through September. So this series, I imagine, is as long as the Lord continues to embolden me in it, we'll continue till the literal end of summer. And our summer series is called, So You're Saved, Now What? So You Are Saved, Now What? And what we have done is, what I've endeavored to do with the Lord, Lord willing, by His Spirit, is to take these last few weeks and talk about the seven I am statements, the seven I am statements that Jesus makes in the book of John. And today will be no different. However, it will be the last, as we may go through seven more interesting things in the Gospels starting this Wednesday. So I want to encourage you to come back. Today's I am statement is the famous I am statement. The famous I am statement. It is the statement that Jesus Christ alone makes. It's the statement that separates Jesus Christ from every guru, every teacher, every coach, or spiritual, spiritual muckety-muck out there. And that's the claim that he is the way, the truth, and the life. Here in John chapter 14, verse 6, he says it very succinctly, I am, agi omio, I am the way, the truth, and the life. And no man cometh unto the Father but by me. What context was Jesus saying this in? What context was he, Jesus, proclaiming this in? Well, we're going to back up a little bit to verse 34 of chapter 13. Verse 34 of 13 John, and we're going to see what context Jesus makes this proclamation in. Jesus is trying to explain to his disciples that he is soon to go to the cross. So you're saved, now what? Now you need to get to know the Christ who has saved you. The Christ who has saved you. The one that Paul has said, it is not I that live, nevertheless it is Christ that liveth in me. Christ, as you have believed in him, placed your faith and trust in him for the forgiveness of your sins, eternal salvation, and resurrection one day, he now lives within you. But he first had to die. He first had to die, and it's in this context that Jesus makes this amazing statement. Muhammad never made a statement like this. Old Siddhartha, Buddha himself, never made a statement like this. Confucius, though as wise and as pragmatic as some of his sayings are, he knew he could not reconcile humanity to its creator. No, here in verse 34 of John chapter 13, Jesus says, a new commandment I give unto you, that ye love one another as I have loved you. This new commandment is new in this sense, because when he says that you love one another, present tense, and says, as I have loved you, past tense, he is directly pointing to the fact that he has come to serve and even die the sinner's death of the cross. We are called to lay our lives down, to mortify the flesh, to die to ourselves. And why? Well, it's the only way we can love one another. It's the only way we can love one another. If we will not die to ourselves, but rather claim the right to be right all the time. If we will not die to ourselves, but rather claim the right to be first, gimme, gimme. Then you know what? We are going to have a very tough time loving one another. Ah, but if we will look at Jesus as our example, it's much, much easier. It's much easier. I know for a fact I am tough to love. I am very tough to love. And I'm just grateful that my wife does. But this may come as a shock to many of you. Some of you are tough to love. Your personalities, your idiosyncrasies, your immaturity. Yeah, that's the big one, your immaturity. That's tough sometimes to love you in spite of those things. Nevertheless, we are commanded to love one another as Christ has loved us. Christ didn't make us totally mature before he went to the cross. Christ did not make us fit into a mold or a type of personality before he laid his life down for the church. Rather, while we were yet still sinners, Christ died for us. Praise God that he did. A new command I give unto you, that ye love one another as I have loved you, that you love also one another. By this all men shall know that ye are my disciples, if ye have love one for another. By this, the whole world is supposed to know that the people that attend Desert Hills Baptist Church on a regular basis, dare I say, the ones who have made professions of faith here, baptized through those waters behind me, and serve here, we are supposed to be known as his disciples for our love for one another. You know, it's invariably, 9 out of 10 problems that come to my desk, 9 out of 10 prayer requests / gossips about people that are whispered to my ears, they're really just personality problems. They're just personality problems. You know, somebody turns somebody's nose, somebody rubs somebody the wrong way, somebody zigged when they should have zagged. And really, I just leave it to the Lord, you know. I always do giggle at the real spiritual ones that they like to use their gossip as a prayer request. Listen, I just wanted to let you know this guy's a super duper stinker. He's a real dog. Just so you know, you can pray for him. I don't need that. I don't need that. What you need is to pray for your brother. And what we need is to learn to love one another through the lens that Christ sees us. Lost, weak, weary. Ah, triumphant in Christ, though. An overcomer by faith in the risen Christ. And soon to be resurrected, possibly even called home in the rapture. You know, if we don't learn to get along and love each other here, why do you think it's going to be different in heaven? See, this is dress rehearsal, folks. Dress rehearsal for that day. May it come. May it come soon. No, he says, they'll know you're my disciples by your love for one another. And then Simon Peter says unto him, Lord, whither thou goest? Jesus answered him, whither I go, thou canst follow me, cannot follow me now, but thou shalt follow me afterwards. Then Peter said, now you can probably write in the liner notes of your Bibles, Peter said, open mouth, insert foot. Peter's always saying things that challenges our love for him and the Lord's patience with him. But Peter said unto the Lord, why can I not follow thee now? I will lay my life down. I will lay my life down for thy sake. And Peter, I believe in the moment, in the heat of the moment, the passion of the moment, Peter meant that. Peter meant that. We ought to watch what we say. We ought to watch what we say. And I've got scripture to back that up. I have a pastor friend, a good pastor friend. One of the only men I would say that when I want to hear the word of God, I go listen to him. The man preached 3 hours one Sunday on altars and places of worship. 3 hours. Now, he has a congregation of about 15 to 20 people. You couldn't handle that. You could barely handle the 40 minutes I'm up here. But I said, I need that. I want to see those notes. But you know what he says that I disagree with? He says, I encourage my people to make vows. I said, oh, snap. I try not to encourage anybody to do anything that Scripture says not to do. Peter says, where you go, I want to go. I would lay my life down for your sake, Jesus. And Jesus says, Peter, you don't know what you're saying. And he makes this next prophetic statement. He says, Jesus answered him, wilt thou lay thy life down for my sake? Verily, verily, I say unto thee, the cock shall not crow till thou hast denied me thrice. And sure enough, in the context of these verses, Jesus is talking about his crucifixion, the illegal trial that he would go through, the humiliation before two courts, the court of Herod and the court of Pilate, the spit that would dribble from his beard that came from the mouths of unbelievers. And he says, no, Peter, you're going to deny me 3 times tonight before the sun comes up. Turn with me to Ecclesiastes. Ecclesiastes chapter 5, verses 4 through 6. We're going to see what the preacher has to say about your mouth and your what you would vow unto the Lord. When thou vowest a vow, Ecclesiastes chapter 5 and verse 4, when thou vowest a vow unto God, defer not to pay it, for he hath no pleasure in fools. Pay that which thou vowest. Now, that sounds like he's encouraging you to make a vow, doesn't it? He's just saying, if you make a vow to God, you ought to pay that vow. You say, well, I gave my life to Jesus Christ. I gave my life to the one who gave his life for me. That's fantastic. So you have vowed now to obey him as your Lord and your Savior. Why haven't you been baptized? That story ain't going to change. You're going to hear it over and over and over again. Why? Because my job as a pastor is not just to bring you at times to the crucible of choice, but it's to lead you into all righteousness. And Jesus Christ himself said, I must need be baptized to fulfill all righteousness. Stop cheating yourselves. Obey God. Fulfill your vow. He says, better it is, verse 5, better it is that thou shouldest not vow. It's better never to go to church and never to have heard of Jesus Christ than to come to church every week, receive Jesus Christ, and then walk however you want to. Because you run both Jesus and yourself through the mud. He says, better it is to not make a vow than thou shouldest vow and not pay. Suffer not thy mouth, verse 6, suffer not thy mouth to cause thy flesh to sin. Neither say thou before the angel, don't even vow before angels, that it was an error, wherefore God should be angry. No. You say, well, that's Old Testament, we're under grace. I love people like that. Let's turn to James. I love people like that because all that does is challenge me to find the New Testament equivalent. The New Testament equivalent can be found in James chapter 4, verses 13 through 15. He basically says, James commends us. Hey, don't say I'm going to go here and there. Don't say I'm going to do thus and such. Don't say I'll buy or I'll sell. Rather, he says in verse 15, for that ye ought say, if the Lord will, we shall live and do this or do that. As the Lord wills. As the Lord wills. Now, I will tell you this. One Sunday, I said, I'll see you Wednesday night. God bless you. Have a great day. I went down to the door, you know, and I'm shaking people's hands, glad handing people, you know, hurry up and go home. I'm hungry. But it's a good up. Have a great day. Yes, God bless you. God bless you. And young lady comes up to me. She says, how dare you? I said, uh-oh. What'd I do now? She goes, you said you would see us Wednesday. You know what the word says. You ought to say, as the Lord wills, I will see you on Wednesday. Well, there does come a point in a Christian's life that whether it is verbalized or not, we do recognize nothing happens unless God wills it. And by the way, that includes the bad things. You know, one of the things, again, with the business media, and I appreciated everything, I could boil it down to this, the what if crowd. What if something bad happens? You know, somebody stole lumber out of our backyard 2 weeks ago, out of the backyard of the church, to the tune of $1,000, $2,000. You said God willed that? No, God allowed that. God allowed that. You ready? I'm going to put my prophet hat on, okay? I'm going to prophesize. You ready? I'm going to tell you the future. Tomorrow, something terrible is going to happen. I'm going to even get more specific. Tomorrow, something terrible is going to happen to somebody. Do you know what else is going to happen tomorrow? Tomorrow, something amazing is going to happen. Amen. Tomorrow, a baby will be born. Tomorrow, someone will win money. Tomorrow, someone will pay off a vehicle. Tomorrow, someone will achieve a degree. Yes, we don't know the future. But we get to a place in our Christian walk where we understand, as the Lord wills, I will do thus and such. But I'm not going to vow I will do it. Lest the Lord buildeth the house, a man labor in vain. Let us not run before him. Let us not lag behind him. Instead, let us seek him in everything that we do. Amen or oh me. Peter says, Jesus, I want to go with you and I'll lay my life down. He says, you don't know what you're saying, Peter. You don't really know what you're saying. I happen to like Peter's passion, though. I've never been part of a building project before. But can I tell you something else? Let me tell you a quick story, then we'll move on with, because this is all in context of now what? Now what? So you're saved, now what? I remember my brother-in-law and I, we got up here on the stage and I'd asked him to do a skit with me. I can't remember what it was for, but he threw a curveball my way. I said, here's the little script, you know, I'm gonna say, hey, you know, get baptized, blah, blah, blah. And then you know, you mull it over, say you pray about us. There's nothing to pray about. It's an act of obedience. And my brother-in-law, he threw me a curveball, Joanne. He goes, so say I get saved, then what? I got to be at the church all the time. I'm like, oh man, you know, Shannon, he caught me off guard with that one. But I thought fast on my feet. I used to be even better at it. I go, no, you don't have to be at the church all the time, but I'll tell you what, you may want to be, you know, you may want to be. No, in keeping with don't say I will or I won't, rather say the Lord will or the Lord won't. In keeping with the idea and the concept that God allows bad things to happen all the time, we're no different, right? But God blesses us all the time too. There's always a first in everything. So I go. Pastor Brown come to me, our music minister. He resigns, leaves us without a singer, all right, and somebody to do this, and it's somebody 10 times more talented than anybody we've had. Let alone me. And Pastor Brown calls me in the office. Ray, I don't know why he called me. I have no idea. You know, I'm teaching college and career study. I'm the janitor. He says, hey, Scott, you know, music minister resigned. We're wondering if you would lead music. Man, I shrank to about 2 inches. I was like, oh, no, why not this guy? He's already singing. He understands the computer back there and the microphones. He goes, I don't know, Scott. Just God put you on my heart. I go, no, why don't you ask him first? So he does, and Mr. Fluffy, that's Quincy used to call him Mr. Fluffy. I won't say his real name, because 2 weeks later he resigns. But in that 2 weeks before he resigned, I really had to go before the Lord. Because see, Pastor Brown didn't know this, but I was in a bad 80s band, Casey. Bad 80s music, synthesizers, everything, you know. Oh, man, and back then I had hair on the bald spot. It was wonderful. Bad 80s music, all the songs about my wife. She hates them still to this day. That's why she throws away every copy we get in the mail. So I said, Lord, I'm supposed to walk by faith, not by feelings. But see, that music had a hold of me one time. I don't want to. Well, you vowed you would sing for me, Scott, if I healed your marriage. So me and Kim at one time, we were not doing good. And I quit the band. I quit all night at the studio. I quit all of that. Why? Well, I need to lay my life down for my wife, because that's what Christ did for the church, for one. And God, if you will give me my wife back, bring us closer together, I will sing for you. That was in 1991, 92. Pastor Brown didn't know I sang in a band, and he surely didn't know I made that vow unto the Lord. And I cried out to God. I said, if you give me a second chance, I will do it. And in the meantime, I talked to my father-in-law. I thought, what I'll do is I'll find somebody. You know how people are. That's how I am. I know where to get my strokes, you know. I think I'll go to my father-in-law with my tail between my legs, my ears back. I'll tell him the predicament I'm in, how I don't really want to do this. And surely there's got to be somebody more talented and better and that can carry a tune in a bucket. And I said, Dad, I said, A, B, and C, you know, I never led music for a congregation before. He said, I was never a master carpenter before either. And I said, what? And he happened to lead music for his congregation. And he goes, and when they came to me and asked me to lead music, I had never led music. I didn't even know how to read music. And I said, what'd you do? He said, well, I faked it till I made it, you know. There's a first time for everything. There's a first time for everything. And if faith was easy, everybody would be believing the Lord. If faith was easy, everybody would be believing the Lord. But here's the thing. If we will believe him for the things he's promised us, hence last week's message, he wants us to be fruitful, then we can expect him to show up and show off. No, Peter had never been in this predicament before, and his mouth got out before him a little bit. And Jesus says, wilt thou lay thy life down for my sake? He says, Peter, you're going to deny me three times. But our God is so good to do, no sooner does the grapes, the vine, wilt a little in the sun, does he lift us back up. And he says, let your heart not be troubled. Ye believe in God, believe also in me. He says, it's all right, Peter. It's all right, because I know you don't understand who I am yet. I know you don't know what's about ready to happen, but I'm giving you that these foreshadows. I'm telling you these things so that when they do happen, you will bring these things to remembrance because they were supposed to happen. He says, in my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. Jesus says, I go to prepare a place for you. Every disciple bought by the blood of Jesus Christ, born again by grace through faith, has a mansion that he is building for you. And it's a place that he is preparing just for you. The joke I tell all the time is, I hope Kim's is real big because I plan on spending a lot of time over there. She's a good cook. Verse 3 says, and if I go prepare a place for you, I will come again. Praise God, he's coming back. He says, if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you unto myself, that where I am, there ye may be also. And whither I go, ye know, and the way ye know. He says, where I'm going, you do know. And the way you do know. And then old Thomas, I love old practical, pragmatic, doubting Thomas, you know. He goes right to the heart of the matter. He says, Thomas saith unto him, Lord, we know not whither thou goest. You haven't given us a map. You haven't given us a didactic blow-by-blow scenario. What are you talking about? He says, we don't know where thou goest, and how can we know the way? And Jesus saith unto him, I am the way. I am the truth, and I am the life. No man comes unto the Father but by me. If ye had known me, he says, you should have known my Father also. And from henceforth, ye know him and have seen him. If you have Jesus, it's impossible not to have the Father. If you have Jesus Christ, it's impossible not to have the Father. Jesus Christ is the express image of the invisible God. I think that's in Hebrews. Check it out when you get home. Jesus Christ is the express image of the invisible God. However, Jesus is God, but he is not the Father. The Father is God, but he is not the Son. And the Holy Spirit is God, but he is not the Father and Son. We have three distinct persons in one God. How can that be? I don't know. I just believe it. Can I tell you something real quick? So you're saved. Now what? You were saved based upon your faith in Jesus Christ, not your understanding of everything. Thank God we're not saved by our understanding. You know, can you imagine? Ed was talking to me this morning about internal combustion engines. Ed, I just want you to know, I was listening to every word, but the brain checked out. The hamster went to sleep for about 5 minutes and woke back up when you said your mechanic fixed the problem. I said, praise the Lord for mechanics. Why? I don't understand that. I know the gas goes in that hole, and I know if you press this down, it goes fast. That's it. That's all I know. I don't understand it. But that doesn't keep me from driving, Priscilla. That doesn't keep me from driving. Nor should your understanding of your salvation keep you from praising the Lord. Nor should your understanding of salvation keep you from being obedient to the one who saved you. Nor should your understanding preclude you from attempting to, and even devouring the word of God. Let's think about the context of this verse again. I'm the way, the truth, and the life. Where was the nation Israel? Wayward. Wayward as can be. He came unto his own, but his own received him not. But as many as received him, to them he gave the right, the power, and the privilege to be called children of God. Only those who find the way are in the way. Everybody else, wayward. What's that sound like to you? Sounds like the United States. Sounds like the northern and southern hemisphere. It sounds like the planet. It sounds like all people everywhere. They are wayward. They need the way. Not a way. Not a way. They need the way. He says, I'm the way. And what else? He says, I'm the truth. Where was Israel? They weren't just wayward, but they were following every wind of doctrine. Think about what the Pharisees and Sadducees had done. The Pharisees had heaped one rule after another rule after another rule on top of the commandments of God. And then what happened? Well, it got so bad, they were following their traditions of men, and nobody knew what the truth was anymore. Jesus says, I didn't come to abolish the law. I came to fulfill it. I am the truth. And then what does he say? Let's think about first century Jerusalem. You think they had a bunch of anti-aging creams then? We're talking about medical science and the advancements. My dad died in 1998-99. If my dad had a heart attack today, he would still be alive because of medical advancements. If my dad had his heart attack today, this afternoon, he would still be here. But, you know, because of the way medical advancements were at the time, almost 30 years ago. Where was Jerusalem 2,000 years ago? Do you know where Jerusalem was? You could get a sliver in your finger and be dead from sepsis within a week. Why? No antibiotics, man. No. The first century saw what was just culminating in this ever increasing crescendo and cycle of birth, death, and birth, and death, and birth, and death. Jesus spoke right to the heart of the matter when he said, "Everyone here is wayward. I am the way." He spoke right to the heart of the matter when he said, "You are all confused and seeking what is true, and I am the truth." And Jesus Christ said, "You are all going to die, and you are all terrified to die. But you don't need to be anymore. Because Jesus said, I am the life." And then one other thing in this statement. He points out to the simple fact that all of humanity has been seeking after their creator in the sense that they know he exists. Even Paul on Mars Hill says, "Here we see you've built an altar. You're superstitious. You built this altar to the unknown God. Let me tell you a little bit about him." And he says, "I'm the way, the truth, and the life," Jesus says. "And no one comes unto the creator. No one comes unto the Almighty. No one comes unto the Father, except by who?" Except by him. So you're saved. Now what? Now, you know, you can say, "I was lost, but now I'm found. I'm found and I'm in the way." Do you know that that was an early title for Christianity? An early title. They called themselves in the way. They would come up and it was kind of like code. They would say, "Are you in the way?" And if the person said, "I might be, let me get out," they knew that wasn't a Christian. No, an early self-identity for the first century Christian was to be in the way, the narrow path. So you're saved, now what? Now no more struggling around in the dark. No more fumbling around through philosophies or creeds. Now you can trust Jesus because he's the truth. Now I'm going to tell you right now, you may not know how to fix your internal combustion engine. But I can tell you this, since Jesus is the truth, if he wants you to know how to do it, you'll get a class. That's what I say. I'm on a need-to-know basis. God always tells me everything I need to know. And what he doesn't tell me, I learn, and he teaches. And so you're saved now? No fear. No fear. Why? Because you're never going to die. Amen. You're never going to die. I got one amen. Some of you got up this morning, you were like me even just a year and a half ago. Some of you got up this morning, you're so full of pain, you didn't want to come, but you came anyway. God bless you. Guess what? You're never going to die. And one day, every tear is going to be wiped away. There'll be no more sickness. There'll be no more pain. Why? Because you have found the way. You have received the truth. And in him, you have eternal life. So you're saved. Now what? Oh, my friends, overcome. Claim the victory that Jesus won and overcome. I'm not saying it's easy, but it is simple.